Please stand and join us as we start worship.
Come set your rule and reign in our hearts again. Increase in us, we pray. Unveil why we're made. Come set our hearts ablaze with hope, like wildfire in our very souls. Holy Spirit, come and fill us now.
Take a moment to greet those around you and then have a seat.
Sorry. Thank you. Good morning, church. Now, let me welcome to Big Hill Christian Church this morning. I hope everybody had a nice Thanksgiving. I'm sure that I got plenty to eat. I hope you did as well. Hope you had a time to meet with family and friends and just have a good time to be thankful for what we were blessed with. Because we are truly blessed, individually and as a community and as our church family. We are definitely blessed. But, as I've heard several times this morning, we're blessed way beyond what we actually deserve. So let's continue to be thankful, even though Thanksgiving season is kind of behind us. If you're visiting with us today, we're especially glad that you're here. I know we do have a few visitors here. And if you're visiting with us for the first time, especially glad that you're here. Come back and see us anytime you'd like to. If you want to share some information about your family or yourself or any prayer needs you might have, take advantage of that tear-out section in the bulletin. So it's on the side. You can just tear that guy out, drop that in the offering plate towards the end of the service, or you can give it to somebody at the exit doors when you leave today, Jim or myself or Jonathan, whoever might be around. But it's great to have everybody here this morning. And again, if you're visiting with us, we're especially glad that you're here. Today is a special day for one family, especially one young man. We're going to have a baptism here a little bit later today. It'll be the end of the service. And I think I'm going to go ahead and spill the beans. Is that okay, Jim? Bryce Peterson is going to be baptized at the end of the service. And even to make it more of a special service, his grandfather, Bruce Holland, from Howland, from Georgia, which is Miranda's dad, Bruce, he is going to be have the honor today to baptize his grandson. So that's going to be a special time for that family today. So that'll be at the end of the service. Just keep that in mind. If you lose track somewhere during the service, your mind wanders off, just think about a baptism we're going to have at the end, and that'll put you right back in the right mind, frame of mind. Jim's back with us today, again. He's going to try to do it. For those that might not know, Jim had a knee replacement surgery several weeks ago, actually a few weeks ago now, and he's been out, but back the last couple weeks. Today he's going to have a full day, I think. He's going to do two morning services, he's going to do the night evening service as well, so we're definitely glad to have Jim back, and he's getting along pretty well. He says his therapist and his surgeon say he's doing really well. He's not progressing as fast as he'd like to, I think, but he's doing quite well. So, Jim, it's good to have you back again. His message today, as you may have seen in the bulletin, is making plans for the next year. And Jim's going to share some thoughts with you about some of his vision and things that we're going to go into next year. Maybe some things that make you think about. And one of the points that Jim had hit this morning and at the 8:30 service, I'm sure he'll do it again this morning, is that what do people think when they drive by our church facility here in Goggins Lane or any of the other churches we have? And Dale and I were talking this morning, within a mile, it's probably another dozen churches. But what do people think when they drive by those churches? And what do they think when they see you outside the church setting, out in the community? So with that thought in mind, let me leave you with a verse from Matthew. Matthew 5, Jim's going to use this verse as well. Matthew 5, starting in verse 14. You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden. Nor does anyone light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on the lampstand, and it gives light to all who are in the house. And this is Jesus speaking to his disciples. And Jesus goes on to say, let your light shine before men in such a way that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven. So let me leave you with that thought this morning as we begin our praise and worship songs. Thank you.
Please stand and continue worshiping with us. You are my portion. You are my hiding
You're coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down. You're coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up. You're coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down. Coming after me. No shadow you won't light up.
Be seated.
Is that better? Oh, yeah. Okay. Good morning, church. No. I think everybody's tracking me so far. As we come into Christmas, where we should be thinking about the birth of Christ, we think about how blessed we are, how fortunate and great it is to have our family around and together as we celebrate the holidays. Is that really what's on our mind? I think Friday probably was a pretty good setting for where we're headed. Stores open. Did you see on the news Saturday all the fights that took place all around the world because of the sales and everything that's going on, the hectic pace that we keep, the things that we're looking forward to? We know what we should be celebrating, but at the same time, there are other things that are in the way. And before we get into that time of year and before we get into thinking about all that kind of stuff, I would like to just take this Sunday, possibly next Sunday, and let's talk about what we have planned for the year. You see, as we look to the birth of Christ, as we look to a sacred time, most of what we do doesn't reflect that. And we know where our hearts should be. And we know what our efforts should be toward. But there's something that we've got to get out of the way first. I mean, isn't that the way we look at it? I know that we should be celebrating the birth of Christ. I know that we should be sharing love and all of sharing in all of our blessings. But right now, I've got to set up for this party. I've got to get those gifts purchased. I've got to get everything done so that I can enjoy the holiday. And what typically happens is we get so involved in the chase that we miss the event until we look back and say, you know, we really should have done it differently. How many years have we done that? How many years have we got caught up in all the have-to stuff that we don't really appreciate the get-to stuff? We're so busy making sure things get done that we don't really acknowledge what we're doing. That's where I want to go this morning and start talking about making some preparations for living our lives, because I believe that when Christmas is over and we catch our breath and we start paying on the bills and we go back to work to try to catch up from where we've been behind, we get so involved in life that just as we go through Christmas, we're going through life the same way. We know what we should be doing. We know what life should be, but we've got to get through this first to get to that. And we spend our whole life chasing things rather than enjoying things. Pray with me. Father, this morning, as we've been given the privilege to come into your house, to open our Bibles and to read your word, to have the Holy Spirit convict our hearts, Lord, I pray that we take a look at what is coming up as far as our calendar and our events and life. And we begin to see what you have planned for us and not what we have planned for us. And just as we talked last week, when we face obstacles and we look at uncertainty and the times that we're in, Father, help us to change our view from believing that you should work for us and begin to see that you want to work through us. Father, I pray that as we celebrate the day and as we look to the baptism that'll be taking place at the end of service here this morning, Father, that we realize that's why we're the church. You tell us to go into all the world and make disciples, baptizing them into your name, and to teach and to train and to continue your love and let the world see it for what it truly is and not what we've made it. So, Father, as you tell us so many times in Scriptures, he who has ears, let him hear. Father, I pray that you open not only our ears, but our hearts. Help us to take in what you would have us to receive and to follow you as we live a life of abundance and joy and victory in Jesus Christ. It's in his name I pray. Amen. What do you think it'll take for us to do the right thing? Think with me for a minute. The commitments that we make, typically as we come to this time of year, we start thinking about New Year's resolutions and what we're going to do differently. What do you have planned for next year? What is it that's on your agenda? What is it that's in your heart you want to accomplish next year? And let me ask you a question or two. What if next year is like this year? How much closer to the Lord will you be in your relationship to Him? What plans do you have made that's going to draw you closer to the Lord? What's another year going to do to you? If next year is like this year, like the year that has passed, what will your life be like this time next year? See, I think we fall into a rut to where we have, I know I do, have all these great expectations for the next year. And you're thinking, boy, once we get this year out of the way and we can start a new year, a new beginning, fresh start, I can see all of this taking place. And I want to accomplish all of these things and do all of these things and have the opportunities come about to where I can accomplish what I want to do. Where is God? Where is your relationship with the Lord in all of those plans? If we were to take a look at our last year, what did we accomplish truly, eternally? You know, what did we set in place that begins to make a difference, not just in our lives, but in the lives of those around us? And the thing that I want to share with you this morning is, as you know, I've had some time to be at home and think. And so some of the plans that I've made and some of the things that I've thought about have all revolved around a prayer that I've been praying. Lord, speak to this church. Lord, make your will known. Give us the direction that you would have us take. And over, I keep thinking of the church. Not just this church, universal, the church. And I begin to wonder, if we have so many churches, as George said, he and Dale had been talking, if there's a dozen churches or so within a mile or two here, why are there so many lost people in that same radius? Why are we so busy and so active with all of our programs and all of what we call our outreach, doing all of the things that we do? Why are there still people who don't know the love of Jesus Christ? And as George mentioned, people drive by this church every day on Goggins Lane. And I know we're kind of tucked back. We're not as obvious as a lot of other churches. But as people who don't know the Lord drive by churches, what do they think? What do you think goes through their mind? And I'm saying you as us, a collective group of believers who profess to be Christians. What is it we think they think? I bet it's not what they truly think. We believe that as they drive by here, it's like driving by the lighthouse that we sing about. And we have our beacon and our light shining. And people see the gospel. They see the love of Christ. They see people who care about other people, those of us who want them to know the Lord. That's what we want them to, what we want to believe that they think. But if that's the case, again, why are they not Christians? You see, I believe, and I've heard from people, and I'm not saying it's a scientific study, but I hear people drive by the church saying, there's that place where all those hypocrites live. That's those people that judge me. Those are the Bible thumpers, the fanatics, those people who spend all of their time judging me and my life and what it should be and comparing them to me and me to them. You know, I don't see the love. If they really cared about me, they'd help me. And they don't get what it is we have to offer, and I wonder why. So what I see the Lord saying to us today, be the church. Be my body. Be my people. And if you go with me, take your Bibles, if you will, go to Matthew. Matthew chapter 5, and look right now at verse 14, and we're going to come back. But right now, verse 5, or chapter 5, verse 14, it says, "You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden." You see the thing that I take when I read that? It's saying you're obvious. You're a church. You sit up on this hill and people see you. You can't hide. And it makes me wonder when I read that, what is it they see? And that's why I asked the question that I asked a little bit ago. What is it that they see? If you will, go on. Let's. I'm kind of jumping around a little bit, but let's go back to that verse again, and let's go ahead and finish verse chapter 5 and look at the following verses. "You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden. Nor does anyone light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on the lampstand, and it gives light to all who are in the house. Let your light so shine before men in such a way that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven." This is what we should be doing. Our light should be so bright and so obvious that people will see it and they'll see the Lord. But if you go to the end of this book and you go to Revelation and you look at chapters 2 and 3 where Christ speaks to the churches, in many cases, what does he say about those churches who are not shining their light, who are not obeying the call that the Lord has put on them? He says, "I'll remove your lampstand. I'll take your light away. You won't be my church." And family, I pray that we do not fall into that category. I pray that as we sit here this morning and we begin to look at the calling that the Lord has placed on each of us individually and on all of us collectively as his body, as that city on a hill, I pray that we begin to make some plans to answer the call. First thing is, what do we do with it? How do we receive the call? And I think if you will, follow along with me. I've got four or five points here I want you to consider. First thing I believe we need to do is let the past be the past. Today is November 25th, 2018. It is not 10 years ago, 20 years ago, when we talk about the good old days. And when we try to reformulate the church today and make it like the church was back then, we can't operate that way because we don't live in those times. And the thing I want you to see is while we can't live that way, we have to live for today. We also need to understand that we are forgiven for the sins in the past. They no longer are with us either. If we have confessed our sins, Scripture tells us that he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. He'll take those sins as far away as the east is from the west. And I think sometimes we cannot function in the present because we're still reaching back to the past. And it still has a hold on us. Paul writes to the church in Philippi in chapter 3, verses 13 and 14. Let me share this with you. He says, "Brethren, I do not regard myself as having laid hold of it yet, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and reaching forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus." It's time we quit reaching back and started reaching forward. Quit trying to bring the past back, whether it's good or bad. Let it go. And let's live in the present. Which brings me to the second point. Let's make the most of it. I don't know who said it. A lot of people have claimed it. But they ask the question, do you know why it is called the present? It's because it is a gift from God that is to be opened and enjoyed. How many times do we go through our life with the gifts that God has given us and we don't use them? We don't open them. We need to make the most of the present. We need to be what we should be, what God has called us to be as we live today in Hebrews. Again, the writer says, but encourage one another day after day, as long as it is still called today, so that none of you will be hardened by the deceitfulness of sin. Why do we not enjoy today? Why are we still holding on to the past? Why do we worry about all the things that are going on around us? Because sin deceives. You've heard me say this a bunch of times before. If we truly realized and recognized the relationship that we have with the Lord and trusted in His promises and believed His assurances, you wouldn't be able to wipe the smiles off our faces. Yet, we come to church and we sing victory in Jesus. We don't mean it. We're singing words because our heart isn't in it, because we're somewhere else. We're judging the people around us. We're comparing ourselves to other people when what we should be doing is enjoying the blessings that the Lord has given us and sharing those with the world that needs Him. But we get hung up on ourselves, and it's not about us. As I said earlier, God doesn't want to work for us. He wants to work through us so others can see Him and not us. And that's why we have problems in churches, because people see the people in the church. They don't see the head of the church because we don't show people that. Which brings me to my next point. Our future. What are your plans? As I mentioned earlier, what is it you hope to accomplish next year? Is that plan eternal? Is that plan spiritual? You know, it never ceases to amaze me the way God works in this family. Our plans for the future, we're going to see part of that in a little bit. There's a young man that's going to be baptized this morning because his family follows the Lord. Because his family instilled in him that desire to serve the Lord with all that he is. And that young man has heard from his folks, from the staff here in our children's ministry, from the people around him, grandpa and grandma, I'm sure, have instilled that in Bryce, that as he grows in the Lord. Because the Lord offers so much more than the world does. And when you see that take place here in a little bit, when you see that generation to generation being handed down as grandfather baptizes grandson, how can you not be excited? How can you not see God at work in a family? And how can you not want that for yourselves? Think with me for a minute. Maybe this is your first step in some plans for next year. Who do you know that needs a relationship with the Lord in their lives? Wouldn't it be wonderful if you could see them come forward on a Sunday morning and accept the Lord into their life? And begin a relationship with Him that God has designed for us to have since creation. And to see that take place and has an impact on the people around them. And they begin to see the Lord. That's the way it's supposed to work. And that's what plans we need to be making in this church for next year. Matthew 28, 18 through 20. Go with me if you will to Scripture and let's look at what it says there. Begin with verse 18. And Jesus came up and spoke to them, saying, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Think about that. All authority. Nothing. No one. No corporate. No corporation. No culture. No government. Nothing has the authority that Christ does. And for Him to personally say to these, His disciples, and us as His disciples, to give us a command, that command comes with the greatest authority ever considered? And he tells them, go, therefore, and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I command you, and lo, I'm with you always, even to the end of the age. What should that do to us as believers, as disciples, as that city on a hill? Knowing that the greatest authority ever is giving us a command to go and to make disciples and to baptize them and to teach them, and to realize that as we go through all of that, Christ Himself is with us and will never leave us, so that we will succeed. He wins. We win. Why are there still people who don't know the Lord in this community? With the charge that we've been given, the authority that backs it, the assurance that the Lord Himself is with us, the Holy Spirit in us, to teach us all things, to guide us and to lead us. How can we not be excited and joyful and energetic and eager to go into the world? I believe it's because, just like we are coming up to Christmas, we've got some other things we got to do first. And once we get that out of the way, Lord, we're yours. Go with me to Luke chapter 9. In chapter 9, Jesus again speaking. Says, as they were going along the road, someone said to him, I will follow you wherever you go. And Jesus said to him, the foxes have holes, and the birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. And he said to another, follow me. But he said, Lord, permit me first to go and bury my father. But he said to him, allow the dead to bury their own dead. But as for you, go and proclaim everywhere the kingdom of God. Another also said, I will follow you, Lord, but first permit me to say goodbye to those at home. But Jesus said to him, no one, after putting his hand to the plow and looking back, is fit for the kingdom of God. Now, we have this picture that this person is saying, Lord, let me go back to the funeral home where my father is in a casket, to go to this funeral service so that I can be there when he's buried. That's not really the case here. He's saying, Lord, once all my family's affairs are in order, once my father has gone and I've received the inheritance that I'm to receive, and I have a sure footing, and I know what my future is going to be like, Lord, then I'll follow you. And he's saying, no, you come now. And another says, Lord, let me go say goodbye to everybody else first. And he says, no. And we think that's kind of hard. That's harsh. But the thing we should see is he's saying, no, this is too urgent. This is too important. We don't know that you have time to go settle your family's estates. We don't know that the Lord is not going to come before you go and tell everybody goodbye. There are people out there that need to be saved from a perverse generation, as he calls it. There are people out there that need the Lord, and they're dying every day, and we're dying every day. This is important, that people go into eternity with the Lord rather than apart from the Lord. We got to be busy. But what we see is, well, we'll talk about that next Sunday during our study time. No, he's saying you go live it right now. You get up and you go out and you begin to introduce Jesus Christ to a world that needs him. Nothing is more important than that. Not even your family. We're to love the Lord our God with all our heart, all our soul, all our mind, and all our strength. Paul writes and says, basically kind of paraphrasing, all I want to know is Jesus Christ and Him crucified. That is the core statement of my existence. That's why I live, to better know the Lord and His death, which brings about my eternal life with Him. Everything else revolves around that. Is that your life? Is that what we have planned for ourselves? Or is there something else we have to get out of the way first? See, I think we have good intentions. But I think we miss the urgency. Charles Spurgeon, you know, I love to read his messages, and I love the way he presents things. He says, we are to wake up each morning and live our lives as though we will have supper with the Lord. Get up this morning thinking that we will have that dinner feast in heaven with the Lord that evening. He will come for us then. We've kind of changed all that around to like live each day as if it was your last. If we were to know that this evening we will be together in heaven, would we live our life differently today? You betcha. One of these days it's going to be right. And we don't know which day that is. I'm sure that there are people that sat in this church building a year ago that are not here today that plan to be. And I want you to think about that person I asked you to think about earlier, that one person you know that needs the Lord. Are you sure you're going to have a long time to bring them to the Lord? You know, we would care about their welfare, but do we care about their eternity? Which is more important? Fourth point. Let's realize what it is we have. The blessed life that we have, the assurance of our relationship with the Lord. And let's live that in such a way that other people begin to see it in our lives. 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 2 says what Paul had mentioned earlier, for I determined to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and Him crucified. Let's live our lives that way. John 14:6, Jesus said to them, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. He's the way to heaven. He's the truth that we search for. He's the life that we've always wanted to live. He's all three of those things. Do we celebrate that fact, that is our Savior? That He is the way I am going to heaven. He is the truth that I live by. And He is the life that I enjoy. Does that describe your life? Or is this something you really wish you had? And as soon as you get this out of the way, that's what I'm going to pursue. We don't have time to play with that. We don't know what we have. John chapter 8, verse 32. And you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free. If you know the Lord, He'll set you free. Verse 36 goes on and says, and you will be free indeed. What's holding you from being free? What has a hold of you? What's keeping you from living that life, from being that person that you feel you've been called to be? I'd be willing to say that it's not anything that you can't overcome, because the love of Christ delivers you from whatever is holding you back. If you will search for me with all your heart, you'll find me, He says. I think we've been playing with it. And I think as a church, as we look to next year, we need to be set free. We need to realize who it is we serve and what it is He asks and what it is He will give us. Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and 2. Therefore, I urge you, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies a living and holy sacrifice, acceptable to God, which is your spiritual service of worship. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, so that you may prove what the will of God is, that which is good and acceptable and perfect. The life that you're living right now, whoever it is, whatever it is that is in control of your life right now, how is that working out? What is that proving to be? This says, if we were to live our life for the Lord as a living sacrifice, it would work out to the point to where we will be able to see His will in our life, which is good and pleasing and perfect. The life that you're living, is it working out that way? As churches, are we serving the Lord in that way to where we see God's will in our lives for our church? Or are we bickering and gossiping and judging and complaining about why people aren't coming to church and why the offering is down and why we can't do this and why we can't do that, and the traditional way of doing things doesn't work anymore? What's wrong with people today? Forget all of that. We don't have time for that. Let's go out and make disciples with the power that the Lord has already given us. He tells us, when you stand before the authorities, don't worry about what to say. I'll give you the words. You just go. The fields are white for harvest. Pray for the workers. Let's encourage each other and strengthen each other and go do the job we're called to do. One more passage. Go with me to Matthew chapter 21. Verses 28 through 32. Listen closely to what this says and determine where you are. But what do you think? A man had two sons, and he came to the first and said, "Son, go work today in the vineyard." And he answered, "I will not." But afterward he regretted it and went. The man came to the second and said the same thing, and he answered, "I will, sir." But he did not go. Which of the two did the will of his father? They said, "The first." Jesus said to them, "Truly I say to you that the tax collectors and the prostitutes will get into the kingdom of God before you. For John came to you in the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him, but the tax collectors and prostitutes did believe him. And you, seeing this, did not even feel remorse afterward so as to believe him." Let's take a real deep look at ourselves. Have we said, "Yes, Lord, I'm yours. Wherever you want me to go, whatever you want me to do, I'll go. I'll do. I'm all in. Lord, I love you with all my heart, soul, mind, and strength. I'll do whatever you ask of me to do." But we haven't. The commands that He's given us that we read every day in Scripture: love your neighbor, help those who need help, be bold in your stance, serve the Lord with everything. Everything that you do, do as unto the Lord. Is that what we're doing? Could it possibly be that we're this son that said, "Yeah, I'll go," and we haven't? And we see by what it says here, that's not God's will. What is it we're going to do? Now, those of you that are members here, you know that on Sunday evenings at 6 o'clock, we're going to set up over here. And I want to talk about some specifics this evening. What can we do as a church to be the church? What are some specific things we can do to put in place to reach the people of Madison County for Jesus Christ? And I'm looking real close at all of you, and I'm trying to remember your faces because I want to yell at you next week if you don't come tonight. I personally plead with you to come together this evening and let's start talking about what we're going to do to actually be the church, because that is what God has called us to be, to put away the past, to get rid of our petty differences, to realize where we are in our relationship with the Lord, in the relationship that we have with people in this community, and start charting a course to bring people to the Lord. That's what I think God is calling us to do as a church. It's nothing new. It's nothing revolutionary. It's nothing extreme. It's nothing out of the box. It's the command that he gave his disciples before he went back to heaven to prepare us a place to come and live with him. Go make disciples. Are we willing to be that church? I pray that we are. And next week we're going to continue in this study and go a little deeper and go a little further. And I'm going to start asking stuff of people because I believe we're called to more than what we have. Here in just a minute, we're going to have our invitational hymn. And as we sing our invitational hymn, I want you to open your ears, open your heart, listen to what the Lord is telling you to do. It may involve you standing right there where you are and repenting of the sins that you've committed, the way that you feel. Ask the Lord to release you from whatever's holding you back from being the Christian he's called you to be. And if you feel strongly enough led to do that and you want to come forward and have prayer, Jimmy will be up front here. We'll have some elders up here. I'll be up here too. Be happy to pray with you and for you. Maybe he's calling you to commit to him fully in obedience by baptism. We're prepared for everything to take place there too. Would love to do that. Let's don't let the busyness of this world blind us from the urgency of our mission. Pray with me. Father, as we come to you this morning, hearing your word, recognizing the call that you're putting on us individually and as a church collectively, Lord, I pray that you forgive us for the sins of our lives, of our past. And that we realize, Lord, that you are true to your word. And when you tell us that our sins are forgiven and removed from us as far as the east is from the west, Lord, that we accept that forgiveness. And we begin to live a new life rather than surviving the old one. Lord, I pray that as we leave this building this morning and we go out into the community and we see the people that we've been talking about and we realize, Lord, the opportunities and the challenges that you're putting in front of us, Lord, help us to have the bold spirit that you call us to have and to stand firm in your word and to reach out to those who need you, Lord, and to be that light that we should be. Lord, help us to realize that in a lot of instances, maybe our light's not shining so bright, and we need to charge it up. Lord, help us to realize that as a church, that's why we're to be here, to encourage one another, to strengthen one another, to pray for one another, so that we can realize how well equipped we are to go into the world. Lord, help us to stay close as a church, closer to you as believers, but Lord, help us to realize our mission. So Lord, as we sing our hymn, please speak to us, lead us, guide us, and direct us. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you will, please stand, let's sing.
How do I say thank you, Lord, for the way that you are and the way that you come? To come, but you always do.
Please be seated. Thanks. Come on up, everybody. You want to hold? Can you hold that? You remember how you've done this before? This is Bryce. And Bryce is going to give his life to the Lord this morning. You know, Scripture tells us unless we receive the Lord as a little child, we won't see the kingdom. He doesn't have anything that's keeping him from accepting Jesus Christ as his Savior. What does that say to us? He has a whole life ahead of him, and we tend to think that a young man with his whole life ahead of him, but we have the same opportunity also. Right now, the Lord is giving us that same opportunity. And so I am so proud of what Bryce is doing and the family that he has that has brought him to this point in his life. And what he's telling us right now about what he's doing should speak volumes to us. And maybe we need to, with Bryce, repeat the good confession of faith. So I'm going to ask you if you will, please stand. And Bryce, I want you, if you will, repeat after me. And everybody else is going to do it to you. So you're going to help lead me, okay? Help them lead them, all right? Okay, I believe that Jesus is the Christ.
Jesus is the Christ.
The Son of the living God.
The Son of the living God.
My Savior. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thanks, baby. I'm going to have a word of prayer, and then we're going to go back and prepare for baptism. So if you will, please pray with me. Father, what a great day. And you tell us, and we know, Lord, that the angels in heaven are rejoicing right now because of the decision that Bryce has made to follow you in complete obedience. So, Father, as we see this baptism take place, this symbolic representation of death, burial, and resurrection, Lord, I pray that you speak to us here in this congregation in such a way that we take part in it as we should and realize what a great God we serve and the willingness that he has to come to earth and to die for our sins so that we can have eternal life with him. Lord, thank you for this family. I thank you for this church. Lord, I thank you for what's taking place in his life. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Let's go back.
So we celebrated Thanksgiving this week. We remembered all the things to be thankful for. And Thanksgiving is a tradition. It's something we've done in years past, and we do every year. And again, every year we come up and have things for that year we're thankful for. And in Jim's sermon today, he talked about, you know, making decisions in the past, but living in the now. You know, we decided to give our lives to Jesus, to follow Christ, but we kind of left that decision and haven't done anything. Well, communion is that time in a service where we're not doing it out of tradition. We're taking this moment to give thanks for Jesus in a lot of ways, to remember his sacrifice and what he did for us. So as we get ready to pass the trays and take the emblems, just meditate on that. You know, again, it's not because something we did last week. It's something to remind us each week of his sacrifice. Each day, mentally, we should be thinking about the thankful things that we are blessed to have Jesus in our lives. So pray with me. Dear Father, Lord, we come to you right now, Lord, to focus, Lord, on a culmination of another week, Lord, in your light. Whether it be through the meals we had in fellowship, our Thanksgiving dinners, Lord, through the music or the message that was brought today, Lord, help us to remember you always. Help us to really focus every day that of a sacrifice we can never repay. And it's through these emblems we recognize that sacrifice. So, Lord, be with us. Help us to focus. Help us to love you. And it's in your Son, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Can you see him? Listen, before I baptize Bryce, I just want to thank Jim. It's very gracious to allow another pastor into your baptistry, and I just really appreciate that. I also want to thank the church for caring enough about children to present the gospel to them. Ready? This is Bryce Peterson. Bryce, have you asked Jesus into your heart and life and chosen to follow him with your life?
Yes.
Then based on your profession of faith and our Lord's divine command, I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried by baptism in the likeness of his death, raised to walk in newness of life with Christ Jesus. It's been done as the Lord commands.
So I'm not even about to try to top that. But I will say a close second. I know a lot of you couldn't see it, but when that little dude held the mic over here and was, you know, doing the confession of faith, I have seen grown men and women wilt like month-old flowers, and this dude's up there like, I got this. You know, I got this. He's just real chill. So before I let you go, I want to bring your attention to a few announcements, especially ones coming up. Next Sunday is the blood drive. I don't know that an appointment is required. I think it's encouraged. So you will find in the bulletin Victoria Cooper's phone number. You can text or call her. She'll schedule a place in like that. 2 weeks from today is the children's Christmas program. That'll be during the second service. And then also starting next Sunday, if you have Christmas cards, rather than fool with addresses and stamps and all that stuff, we'll have an area in the foyer. All you got to know is the name. And you can drop them off with somebody, and we'll sort them through, and people can kind of pick them up all month long. So it's another great day to be in the house of the Lord. You can't top that. So I'm going to ask you to stand, and I'm going to pray to close us out. Bow with me. Dear Father, Lord, what else can we say? Anytime a person, young or old, decides to give their life to you, Lord, there's nothing greater. It's another soul, Lord, living right, choosing right. So, Lord, what we pray right now is, as we do on baby dedications and other things, as a church, that we surround the Petersons with love and support, that we're there. Because, Lord, we know now that Satan's going to paint a big bullseye on that little guy's heart, on his chest, and he's going to come after him. And he needs the whole church to help lift him and carry him through those times. Lord, he's on the right path, and it's up to all of us to keep all of us on the right path. So, Lord, as we go out, let us not forget you, and let us not leave you in these four walls, but take you with us wherever we go, giving thanks. And, Lord, just realizing this is every day, not just this season, is a time to be thankful, the time to rejoice in the blessings you've given us, and just share that love with others. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Have a good week.